Good morning, grade 12. Welcome to Life Sciences lesson. I'm Mr. Sothaka, the lead teacher from OR Tambo Inland at Mthatha. This topic still continues with our topic on the human response to the environment, but we are only focusing today on the eye structure and the function of the parts of the eye. Right now, before we move any further, our examination guidelines tell us that on this part of the eye, you need to know the structure and function of the parts of the human eye using the diagram and binocular vision and its importance. Now, our lesson objectives from the examination guidelines, what you as the learner need to know at the end of this topic, you need to be able to study the structure and functions of different parts of the human eye. Of course, in life sciences, we study the structure of the diagrams, and then we will be asked to answer the questions based on the diagrams, give the function of the parts that are labeled on the diagram. But then you need to teach yourself to study the diagram first, see what is given there, and then move on to the question and see what is asked. You don't just label everything on the diagram. Right, and then explain the structural adaptation for various parts to perform their function. Of course, you will be told that the certain part, like the cornea, for example, is transparent. It allows the light to pass through. Now, what if the cornea is not transparent? What will happen to that? So you need to be able to explain how the part is adapted to perform its functions. Then later on, you need to be able to explain the concept of binocular vision and stereoscopic vision, which will be explained later on the topic. Now, these are the terminologies that you need to familiarize yourself with. We'll be using them more often when we are doing this topic. Refraction, bending of light when it passes through the lens. Generally, the word refraction means the bending of light wave when it passes through different mediums. For instance, when the light coming from the space, it enters through our eyes, so it's coming from a different medium and enter to another different medium. So there are structures, the lens and the cones are responsible there. Sorry, the cornea are responsible there to refract and bend the light so that it can focus the image where it is formed. Photoreceptors. Already you know what our receptors are. These are the structures or organs that help us to pick up the stimuli from the environment. In our eyes, we have photoreceptors, which are receptors in the eye that convert light stimuli into an impulse. So the word photo means light. We are familiar with this term. Photo means, which means our light, our eyes are sensitive to light stimuli. Photoreceptors are located in the retina, the part of the eye, and there are two types of receptors in our eyes, the rod and the cone cells. We'll explain them later on. Binocular vision, definition of this term, the process of looking at an object with both eyes, creating a single visual image. Well, the word binocular, this is the word derived from Latin, bini, means twice or double or two things, and oculus means vision. So binocular vision basically means to see with both eyes and to create an image on the brain. Stereoscopic vision, the ability to see the depth and solidity of objects and create a three-dimensional presentation of an object. Well, stereoscopic vision basically means where when we see the object with our eyes, we can be able to determine how deep, if you are looking at the clear water or the pool, if you are standing on a cliff and you are looking down, you can determine how deep it is or how further it is down there. Yeah, so the process of being able to determine the depthness and the solidity of objects and create a three-dimensional object in the image is called stereoscopic vision. Now let us look at the location of our eye, the external structure of the eye. Of course, our eyes are located in the eye sockets. This part here is called the eye sockets. If you're looking next to your friend, you will see the eyebrows. This is the part that protects the eye from the sweat, water, or any debris that may try to fall to your eye. And then beneath the skin here, these are our lacrimal glands, also known as tear glands. They produce tears. They keep the eye moistured. They're also antiseptic. They kill bacteria or any foreign matter that may stay on your eye. And then the eyelashes, they are there on the eyelids. The eyelid is used to blink and also to close our eyes when you sleep. And then this hair-like structure is the eyelashes, also traps the dust particles that may try to penetrate through your eye. Now this is the exposed part that you see from your friend's eye. The white part here is called the sclera. And then that dark spot there, this is not a structure, it is the opening called the pupil. It is where the light enters our eye. The image of what you see enters through this spot here. And then this part that is colored here, it's pigmented. To some people it's blue. To others, it's a green, brown. This is called the iris. It's got the muscles that are flexible. They regulate the size of the pupil, this opening here. Right. And then if you are looking at if you take out the eye, as much as you see the smaller part of the eye that is exposed, but in actual sense, the eye is as big as you can see on this diagram when you take it out on the eye socket. This is how you view the eye. But in our eyes, you can only see this frontal exposed part, not it. Right now, let us look at the structure of the human eye into detail. Now, this is the longitudinal section of of the eye. This is the anterior part of the eye, which shows what you see into your friend's eye. This is the exposed part of the eye, and then this is the posterior part that is just under the eye socket that you cannot see. Now the outermost layer, this white part here, is called the sclera. The sclera forms the outer covering of the eye. It is the white part, start from the white part that you see and goes all the way to the back of the eye. Now, as we are saying, it is the covering, which means it serves as a function to protect the inner parts of the eye. So everything inside here is protected by this layer. Also, another function is to attach the eye muscles, which enables our eyes to change direction, to see up, down, sideways. The muscles that change the direction of the eye are attached, they arise from this layer, the outermost layer, which is the sclera. Now here on the front of the eye, the anterior part, there's a thin membrane which is not shown. The structure is not clear. Here is the thin clear membrane, transparent, protecting the cornea. So this structure here is the cornea, but just outside the cornea there's a thin membrane which protects. It's called the conjunctiva. The cornea is transparent and is curved as the front part of the eye, and the main function of the cornea is to refract the light rays which enter the eye. Now with the eye, so when the light passes through the eye, it is refracted, it bends here and focused inside the eye. And then this space here just beneath the cornea, this is called the aqueous humor. It is filled with a fluid which gives the shape of the cornea, and also it supplies oxygen and nutrients on this anterior part of the eye. So the aqueous humor contains this fluid which keeps the shape of the cornea curved as it is to refract the light as it enters through. So also, as it is a clear fluid, it also assists minor role in refracting the light, because the light passes through it as it enters through the eye. And then this part here, this is the part we said it is sometimes blue from other people, it's brown. This is the iris. So the pigmented muscular structure contains the inner ring cell called the circular muscles and the outer layer of radial muscles. These muscles will be explained further into details when you are doing the pupillary mechanism, which will be explained later on in the topic. Controls the size of the pupil. So the main function of the iris is to control the amount of light that enters through the pupil. So it regulates the size of the pupil. There is the pupil. This is the opening in the iris where the light enters through. So we're saying the pupil is not a structure, it is just an opening. This is the dark spot that you see into your friend's eye. You'll see the dark spot in the center there. That is just an opening. It is regulated by this iris according to the amount of light. If you're in the dark room or if you're in the bright light, the size of the pupil changes. The process will be explained on the pupillary mechanism. Now, moving on to the inner part of this anterior part of the eye, this is the lens. The lens is elastic. It is transparent by convex structure. Its elasticity allows it to be to change to alter or to change the size of it. Also, the transparent part allows the light to pass through. By convex, we mean that it is containing two structures that you can. In fact, it is made like an ovule-like structure. So the light passes through this side, which is curved outside, and the other one is curved on the other side. So this is what is meant by biconvex. It is curving in two sides. So when the light enters here, it is altered and changed the side as it leaves on this other side. So the image is refracted here because of this biconvexity of the structure. So that is the main function of the lens. So yes, the lens, it is to reflect and focus the light to the retina. So the image that enters here is inverted and focused there on the retina. Right, and then the next structure here is the suspensory ligaments. This is the structure attaches exactly on the lens. So this structure, helps to alter the size of the lens. These are the structures that move so as the lens changing its form. If they are attached here on this blue structure, which is called the ciliary body and the ciliary muscle. So there's a dot in the center here, which is the ciliary body. Around it is the ciliary muscle. So all these muscles together with the suspensory ligament, they hold the lens and then they keep changing its convexity. Right, moving on to the innermost layer. This is the part here which is blue in color. This is the mid layer of the eye. This is the part which the ciliary muscle and the suspensory ligaments together with the iris, they arise from the mid layer. So it continues all the way to form the iris, and it also forms the ciliary muscle and the suspensory ligament. So the choroid is a dark pigmented layer. Some textbook will say it's brown, and its dark pigment helps to absorb the light. So as the light is refracted passing through, it is absorbed so that it won't be scattered the eye. So it keeps the light passing straight to focus, assisting in absorbing the light so to where the image will form. And the main function also, this part is supplied with blood vessels, which enables it to supply oxygen to the eye and also the nutrients to the eye. And moving on to the innermost layer, this part here, the brown part, this is called the retina. This is the site where the image is formed. The retina also contains the photoreceptors, the receptors that allows our eyes to see. They convert the image, what we see, into impulses so that it will send to the brain and the brain interpret what we are seeing. So the image that we see falls here on the retina, and then it is converted into an impulse. So we call this is the site for, it's the site where the image forms and also convert the stimuli, the light stimuli, into an impulse, because the brain cannot read the stimulus, it can only read an impulse. So the photoreceptors, there are two types of photoreceptors in our retina, the cones and the rods. The rods, some learners tend to confuse the two words, the cones and the rods, which one is responsible for what. So the rods are responsible for vision in dim light. You will use the mnemonic as D, rod. This word is containing the letter D, so that is for dim vision. And then the cones are helping us to see on the bright vision or colors. So those are the main functions of these receptors. So they convert the stimuli on the dark light and this one on the bright light, and form and change that stimulus into an impulse, and it will be sent to the brain. Right. And then this curved part here on the retina, there's a chip part here which is curved, small chip here, that is called the fovea or the yellow spot. This part contains only the cones, and we know it as the site where a clear image is formed. This is where you see the best image of what you see is forming here. And then it is sent to, it is converted into an impulse and sent to the brain. Right? And then where these structures, these nerves that are uniting here, there is this part here which is called the blind spot. The blind spot is just where the nerves are uniting as they go out to the brain. So if an image falls here, there are no receptors, so you won't see anything here. Hence, we say there are no photoreceptors, which means there is no vision occurring in this part, which is called the blind spot. It is exactly where this part goes out to the brain. Now, this posterior part, the whole part here of the eye, is called the vitreous humor. Now, learners also tend to confuse which one falls where, the vitreous humor and the aqueous humor. Remember, aqua, this is the first letter A in the alphabetical letters, and it is followed by V. V is comes after A. So the first chamber here is the aqueous humor, and then this one is the vitreous humor, in case you confused which one goes where. Right. The structure here is a jelly-like structure. It helps to maintain the eyeball. So the eyeball, as it is round in shape like this, this jelly-like structure keeps the structure of the eye. Also plays a minor role in reflection of light, as in refracting of light as the light passes inside the eye. And then when the image, after the image has, the image is converted and formed in the retina, then it is sent to the brain via the optic nerve. So this structure here, which goes all the way to the brain, is called the optic nerve. So it carries the impulse from the retina to the cerebrum. So the part of the brain called the occipital lobe. It's not necessary to know that part, but just know that the image that has formed in the eye
is converted into a nerve impulse, into an impulse, and sent to the brain via the optic nerve. Now, looking at how the image forms in the retina, so the light from the space, if there's an image, say for example you are looking at your friend standing in front of you, the light shines on your friend, then the image of your friend is reflected to your eye. So basically this means that everything we see with our eyes is a reflection. Don't confuse the word refraction and reflection. Reflection means to the light bounces here and comes to your eye. It is pushed to your eye. So the image of what we see is what is reflected to our eyes. And then when the light enters the eye, it is refracted now. It is bent and focused to the retina where the image will form. So this is the direction that these arrows will indicate how the light goes. It comes from outside, that is from the space. It enters through the cornea and passes through the pupil to the lens, through the vitreous hammer, to the retina, and then here the stimulus of the EF of the light is converted into a nerve impulse, and it is sent to the brain via the optic nerve. Now let us look at how the process of seeing the light occurs. This is the friend in front of you, and the sun or the light shines on him, and then the image of your friend is reflected to your eye. Now, as it passes through the eye, it bends. You can see these lines, they show that this is refraction. The first refraction, the light bends here on the cornea, and then it is passes through the pupil, the space here, and enters to the lens. The lens is biconvex, meaning that it inverts the image. As the image enters here, the position that it enters is not the same as the one that it leaves. So this is curving on the outside, this one is curving on the inner side. So the image here is inverted. So basically, this means that our eyes see the world as inverted. Everything that forms in the retina is upside down. But after it has passed through, the retina has converted this image into a nerve impulse. When it goes to our brain is able to correct the image now back to the upright position. So as it is where you see it. So the refraction only occurs as the light passes through the cornea and the lens and forms an inverted image in the retina. And then the retina converts this image, which is a light stimulus, into an impulse and send it to the brain. Then our brain correct the image and interpret what we are seeing. So this means that everything that we see in our eyes, you can open your eyes and see. But if the brain cannot tell, if the retina does not send the impulses to the brain, we cannot interpret what we see. You can see someone, they will tell you that this person is blind, but you can see him, the eyes are open. It means that there is a defect that does not allow the brain to interpret what is seen by the eye. So you can see the eyes open, but they cannot see. So this is the summary now of how the light enters through our eyes until it is interpreted in the brain. We said the light is reflected on an object. It goes through conjunctiva, the clear membrane that is just protecting the cornea, and then the light enters through the cornea. It passes through the aqueous humor, that is the fluid in the anterior part of the eye. From the aqueous humor, it passes through the pupil, from the pupil to the lens. This is where a second reflection that inverts the image occurs. From the lens through the vitreous humor, from the vitreous humor to the retina. Now, in the retina, we said we have the photoreceptors, the rods, and the cones, which are responsible for dim vision and bright vision. Then the retina has these receptors convert the image into an impulse. Then the impulse is sent via the optic nerve to the cerebral cortex, that is to the brain, where the interpretation of what we see occurs. Now that brings us to the end of our presentation. Now looking at, that is only the end of the presentation part of the eye structure. Now looking on the term of binocular vision, we've mentioned earlier, binocular vision, we said in division, it means to see with both eyes. So our eyes are placed in distance apart. They create the ability to observe two separate images. As you can see in the structure here, these are our eyes, this is the brain, this is the object that our eyes is looking at. So this means that on the right eye there's an image, on the left eye there's also an image. But in the brain, both views of image are merged and in the brain and form a single image. So there is one object, but there are two objects in each eye, but our brain is able to form a single image of what we see in a three-dimensional form, that you can see all direction of this. And then that is what is meant by binocular vision. And one advantage of binocular vision is that it gives a wider view and help the person to estimate the size, the distance, and the depthness. That is called stereoscopic vision. So being able to see when you are standing next to the pool, and you can see from outside how deep is the pool there. So that perception of being able to determine the depthness of the pool, that is called stereoscopic vision, as it occurs in our brain. It is the main functioning of our eyes together with our brain in interpreting what we see. That brings us to the end of the topic.
All right, now I have two activities here, just short worksheets that I want us to go through, just to check our level of understanding up to so far. But later on at the end of this lesson, there will be a worksheet accompanying the whole thing just to assess you. Now, I want us to look at this activity, activity one. It says the diagram below represents the structure of the human eye. Now, we have to study the structure. You can see what is labeled here. Light stimuli coming from the source, entering through the eye all the way to the brain where it's interpreted. Now, question, the instruction says, give the letter and the name of the part which regulates the amount of light entering the eye. Right here, you are shown the site where the light enters and the structure that regulates the amount of light entering the eye. That will be here, labeled letter B, that is the iris. Yes, the iris is labeled letter B. So there are two marks. Note, there's a mark for the letter, mark for giving the word. Number two, supplies food and oxygen on the eye. And the labeled part here, remember we said the inner structure here, this dark part D, labeled D, that is the choroid, contains the blood vessels, which supply the nutrients to the eye and also oxygen as well. So that would be D, choroid. 1.1.3, transmit impulses to the brain. Right, we know the image forms here on the structure here, the retina, and then the image is converted into impulse, and the impulse are sent via through the structure here labeled E. That would be optic nerve. Right, E, optic nerve. 1.1.4 contains cones and is the area of clearest vision. Now, remember again here we said on the retina, we have the cones and the rods and the structure there, that curved part here labeled C. That will be the fovea or the yellow spot. It contains the cones and the best image forms here. So that will be C, fovea or yellow spot. Number 1.1.5, assist in the refraction of light rays. Right, the labeled structure here, refraction, we know it happens here on the cornea and also on the lens, but the part labeled now is A. So that would be A, cornea. Cornea, okay. Right, let us look at the next activity. Activity 2. Diagram below represents the structure of the human eye. Right, you study the structure and see what is labeled and what is given all the way. Now, question number 2.1.1 says, name the parts in the correct sequence through which the light passes in order to reach structure H. Structure H, okay. As the light enters through all the way, which part passes through until it reaches this part here, the retina H, okay. So, the first part that is labeled here, the light will enter through part B. That is the cornea, and then it will pass through a structure labeled C, pupil, pass through G, the lens, and all the way until it reaches H. So the labeled parts that show the light B, C, G, until it reaches H. Yeah, there it says. Then 2.1.2, explain the consequences if the light rays were to fall on path F. Path F, this is the part where the neurons unite to form the optic nerve. Remember we said here there are no rods, there are no cones, no rods, yes, there are no photoreceptors, which means there is no image occurring here. So you won't be able to see. So basically that's how you see. There are no receptors present, no image will be formed, or you cannot see the object here, so the light will not be converted into an impulse if it were to fall on this part. Right, and 2.1.3, explain two ways in which the lens is structurally suited to perform its functions. Yeah, now remember I said on your textbook, they will tell you that this part is a structure of this nature and its function is to do this and that. But now, what are the structural suitability for it? What does this structure have that enables it to perform that function? Now, the lens, remember we said it refracts light, so by changing its shape. So, which means this lens is flexible or it is elastic. It allows a changing of the shape so as to focus the light. Secondly, it is transparent, that is, it allows the light to pass through it, and there are four marks there. So you also need to mention that it refracts the light to invert the image that forms in the retina. Right, that would be your response is there. Right, now this brings us to the end of this lesson. Surely you will receive a worksheet that will ask more questions based on the structure and the functioning of the eye. That will be the end of our lesson. Thank you.